The moment when Blizzard enacted especially harsh punishment on Hearthstone player Blitzchung for saying free Hong Kong on stream has been eye-opening for many fans. As China's middle class grows, entertainment providers have had to tackle this important question. How do we protect our reliance on the Chinese market without alienating our domestic fans? This is also a question that the anime industry has been asking itself, leading to the claim made by fans and professionals that China will become the largest market for anime. Discussing this claim is difficult because although we do have data, the methodologies aren't clear enough to be able to make direct comparisons. To put it simply, numbers are all over the place, and it's not clear enough on how they all got to them. But here's the thing, at the highest estimates, China has already overtaken the Japanese market for anime, and at the lowest estimate, it's on the way. China has more than 10 times the population of Japan, so as long as there are fans in China, it's reasonable to expect that there will be money. So with that said, across all speculations from industry professionals and researchers, every possibility points towards this myth being confirmed. But let's talk about what exactly this means in regards to government intervention, local Chinese productions, and the potential effect on the medium as a whole. In the special English edition of the Anime Biziance magazine, the authors used this opportunity to talk about the increasing reliance on foreign markets. One column was written by Yuji Mori, the president of the consulting branch of advertising giant Dentsu, and opens with the question of whether Japan will become China's, quote, anime-making factory. At this point, overseas licensing is the essential part of recuperating costs, with the 2018 AGA report showing that money coming in from overseas was steadily on its way to overtaking all domestic revenue. The anime industry is now worth a massive amount of money, and it continues to grow, which according to the report is largely due to the growth of the anime market in China and deals with multinational platforms like Netflix and Amazon. But with money comes control, which is Yuji Mori's concern. He believes that the amount of shows financed and owned by Chinese companies but produced at Japanese studios will increase, and could strain the already complicated relationship between a lot of financiers and the animation studios creating the shows. Basically, Mori envisions more anime being like Neo-Yokio, where the entire show is developed and owned overseas, and then they just get a Japanese animation studio to make it, rather than being more involved in the concept phase themselves. It's cynical, but there is some precedent for it. On a personal level, Chinese companies investing in anime isn't an issue. Instead, it's that the production committee system already drives a distance between themselves and small animation studios. I believe that instead of working to drive out Chinese investors, animation studios should be lifted up and be able to have more power and influence over the shows they create by default. Right now, a studio can create an incredibly successful show and still go bankrupt. That's not an issue with China, that's an issue that already exists. But even with that said, especially with the Blitzchung incident, it's hard to ignore that with Chinese investors can come a set of complications. I do want to make it clear here that Chinese fans are never at fault for loving anime. A lot of discussions regarding China can devolve into racism really quickly when those Chinese fans are just as annoyed about all this government nonsense as we are. Right now, the Ministry of Culture and Tourism, the National Radio and Television Administration, and several other government bodies have the ability to threaten local companies and restrict the media they import. Even if Chinese companies have invested hundreds of thousands of dollars into a Japanese show, the government can stop it from entering China in any way, just like that. And this is just in regards to digital streaming. As far as I'm aware, the government has not granted a broadcast license for any modern TV anime. The reasons why anime could be prevented from entering China are broad and inconsistent. Generally, media can be banned for violence, crime, sex, politics, and LGBT rep. In 2015, they published a list of anime including Attack on Titan, High School of the Dead, and specifically Sword Art Online Season 2 that would not be able to be digitally broadcast. This is after Chinese licensors had already paid to show them. So, here's the issue. If Chinese companies have an influence over the industry and companies are relying on them investing in and licensing Japanese anime, where is the incentive in creating shows with this sort of content that these companies fear might just get banned after they've paid for them? all of this is naturally cynical, but it does fit the trend in other media, where elements of script or production design might be changed to appease the administration. Of course, it's also worth mentioning that the local Chinese animation industry, mispronounced as Donghua, is also growing, with some productions like Big Fish and Begonia and The King's Avatar taking inspiration from Japanese animation. Kemono Friends producer Yoshitada Fukuhara predicted back in 2017 that the Chinese industry would overtake Japan in both production and skill within a decade. And so it may come to pass that compared to investing in their own Chinese productions, investing huge amounts in the Japanese animation industry might just not be worth it. China has also been offering some pretty decent salaries and benefits for animation staff, which has some in Japan concerned about the Chinese industry being able to poach talent from anime. Which is fucking ironic. We can be concerned about Chinese government bodies and censorship, but the concerns about Japan being an anime-making factory or Chinese animation stealing animators are based on the same problems that Japanese animators have been talking about for years. The only difference is now there's competition. Thanks for watching The Canepa Effect. Please keep your myths coming by either messaging at The Canepa Effect on Twitter or messaging anonymously on Curious Cat. I don't respond to these submissions individually, but I do read and consider every single one of them. This channel is supported by Patreon, and I'd like to give a special thank you to all of these wonderful people. In particular, I'd like to give an extra special thank you to Austin Hardwick, Chariot Wheel, Dead and Meat, Ellipsism, Frogkun, Jacob Bosley, Jakob Gard, JR Pictures, Mike Tamborelli, Nolan Soga, Ryan Rodriguez, Shishi, That Yuan Artist, and my own mother. If you'd like to support the channel, then please visit patreon.com/thecanepaeffect.